Hello everybody and welcome to Arun Church Online. My name's Becca and I lead the church with a fantastic group of people. We're normally meeting together in a school hall, 400 of us, and we can't do that right now. So for now, welcome to Arun Church Online. We're so pleased you're here. Whoever you are, wherever you come from, welcome.
Here at Arun Church, we are passionate about our local community, which is why we run the Wickbourne Centre and the Play Centre Nursery and the Preschool, Arun Youth Projects and various children's and youth activities and the Cadet Centre. But we would love to invite you to an Alpha course, an opportunity to learn about the Christian faith in an informal environment from the comfort of your own home. To find out more about the Alpha course or any of the things that we run in the community, go to arunchurch.com.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Arun Church Online. You are so welcome wherever you are, whoever you are, to join with us this morning. We hope you are blessed and you really enjoy meeting online with us this morning. Please do jump on the YouTube chat and say hi wherever you're from and get involved. We've got so much coming up this morning, including summer fun. Pippa Harson's going to be leading us in our final episode of Garden Chats. And Becca is doing a short talk this morning based on Matthew 4. And straight before that, we've got our worship team going to lead us in a time of worship. So let's just pray, shall we? Father God, we just give this time to you wherever we are. Whatever's going through our minds, we just lay it aside right now. And we want to take this time to focus on you. Father, would you, by your Holy Spirit, just come to us right now, fill us afresh this morning with your Spirit as we worship you in spirit and in truth. Amen.
For God so loved the world that he gave us. of the cross, Jesus is waiting with open arms. For God so loved the world that he gave us, his one and only son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. The power of hell forever defeated. Now it is well, I'm walking in freedom. For God so loved the world.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow.
Good morning, church. Welcome to Summer Fun. We've been at Arun Youth Summer this week and we're going to show you what we've been up to. See you soon.
Good morning, everyone. My name's Pippa, and I have got the privilege today of chatting to three absolute legends of our church. And so, ladies, please just introduce yourselves to us and just tell us a little bit about yourselves.
Well, I'm Brenda, and I'm married to John, and we have two fantastic sons who We have four grandchildren, and we've got two great-grandsons.
Wow.
Who are very special.
Oh, lovely. Thank you, Brenda.
And I'm Pam, and I've got three lovely children, two sons and a daughter, and I've got five amazing grandchildren.
Brilliant. Thank you, Pam.
And I'm Lesley, and I'm married to John, and some of you might know Mark and Becky, and Mark's our son, so if you know them,
I think most people know Mark.
Yeah, so Mark, Becky, Red and Sol are part of our family.
Fantastic. Brilliant. Thank you, Lesley. So, ladies, how would you describe the last sort of year, 18 months for you? How's it been for you?
Well, for me, the first lockdown was fine because you just thought, oh, this isn't going to last, and the weather was good and you got on with things and it was absolutely great. And then as it went on, I think I struggled with loneliness, and I struggled with not seeing my family. And then I moved in all of that, so I struggled more because you just don't get help. You know, there just isn't the help to
help,
when you move, and that was really hard. And then my sister had a stroke, and she was unconscious for 4 months, in a coma for 4 months.
Wow.
And that was really hard because you couldn't visit. And then you could visit, so then you had to wear all this PPE stuff. Mm-hmm. And then you realised again just how hard it was for all the people working, you know, in those sort of places where you have to wear PPE all the time.
Yeah.
And so that's another dimension of it. But in it all, I think every day is a day that God's made.
Mm.
And I think he's taught me lots of things. There's been ups and downs, but I know that there'll be something good that comes out of it.
Yeah, amazing. Mm. Thank you, Pam. What a story, yeah. Lesley?
Well, I felt quite cushioned during the lockdowns because we don't go out to work. You know, we haven't had to worry about money or getting to work, or everything's been fine. Yeah, and I've been very, very busy because some of you will know that I do lots of sewing. So I was making scrubs.
Oh,
so okay. I think I made about 100 scrub tops, not so many trousers. And then that was all the first lockdown to about September. And then when they started vaccinating, they needed more scrubs, so I made some more.
Wow.
So
how many
I haven't,
do you think you've made in total then?
I don't know. The last lot were 22 because somebody found a leftover roll of fabric, so I was the one that got it, and that made 22.
Wow.
Yeah, so I've...
So you've been busy.
Yeah, I have missed my family, obviously,
yeah.
And the grandchildren, because other family are further away, but with Mark and Becky being near, at least we've seen quite a bit of them.
Yeah.
So that's us.
Yeah, great. What about you, Brenda?
Well, I was thinking of how could I describe it in one word? Well, that's a bit difficult, but I'd say it's been tough. Mm-hmm. But there have been good things as well as bad things. Mm-hmm. I think the good thing, particularly because our sons don't live near us, was one of them came to live with us for a month, him and his wife. And that was brilliant. We haven't lived together for a very long time, but it was brilliant.
Oh,
and we'd have a bit of a competition who'd make the best meal. So it kind of made life a bit more interesting.
Fantastic.
So that was really good. There's been downsides as well. We've lost quite a few family members.
Right.
Some have died from old age and others have died from COVID.
Mm.
And sometimes we couldn't get to the funeral and sometimes we couldn't get to the funeral. So that's been sad.
But
God's been good.
Yeah.
We felt protected and God's always there, isn't he?
Yeah.
So
exactly.
That's been good.
Absolutely. So what do you think is the biggest thing that God's sort of been speaking to you about in the last kind of year, 18 months? And how do you feel about going back to TLA, to church, as it kind of, you know, was back at TLA?
What has God taught me? I think more than anything is I need to get into a new rhythm of life. Mm-hmm. I think we've been kind of forced into it in a way, but it makes you reflect on what is my life about? What do I do? Do I need to do that or that?
Mm.
And I realised that perhaps I need to get into a new rhythm.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm trying to discover what that really means.
Mm-hmm.
And I love being with people. One of the hard things with lockdown was actually not seeing people and not seeing family.
Mm.
And I just love to be with people. But maybe I've done that too much.
Mm.
And I think God is trying to say something to me here. And there's a something, I think it's in Hosea, and it talks about, I will allure you into the desert where you will find my heart.
Mm.
And I think, I don't really like deserts, I don't really like isolation, but I think God's saying, well, come with me and I'll show you more than you've ever known before.
Amazing.
So we'll wait and see whether I can get into a new rhythm.
Yeah.
And yes, as soon as church was opened up, we were there. Because I think it's so important to be together, to be family, to worship together. And just, you know, it's like iron sharpening iron, you know, we encourage one another, we bless one another, and I just can't wait.
Yeah, brilliant. Thank you, Brenda.
Well, I learnt very early on to wait for God, and I think that was in that first lockdown. God spoke to me a lot about, I'm always running on to the next thing, and I was to wait. Mm. And if I waited, I would hear him. And I've been putting that into practice. But alongside that, there's a couple of scriptures that have come back to me over the years. And one is when Jesus said to his Father, let them be one as you and I are one, that the world will see. And I think in a degree you see that more and more, but I want the more for that. And in Acts, when it talks about they met together and ate together and prayed together and they shared all things in common, and I think we see a degree of that, but not the full degree of what God wants us to see. So I'm sort of running with those two scriptures, and I long for church to be church again, because I can't believe that in all we've been through, God is going to make it the same. I think he's got a plan. And I want to be part of that plan. Mm. And I know that these scriptures God speaks to me about, I'll see the bigger unfolding of those as well. So yes, I'm longing to get back to church because it can't be the same.
Yeah, brilliant. It's lovely, thank you.
So the thing God really, new thing God showed me over the lockdown was that when he says my feet are on a rock, I've always imagined this sort of quite small rock about the size of my feet, really. Mm-hmm. And he showed me that actually it's a great big rock, and I can, it's straight, it's not, I can't remember the word, sorry, it's not knobbly. Yeah. And I'm quite secure on there, and it's big, so I can walk about. So then when he gives me something to do, he gives me the tools that I need and skills that I need, and I'm standing on this rock and I can do whatever it is, and he's right there beside me, so he's making sure I do it right, if you see what I mean. Mm-hmm. And that's the big thing God showed me, apart from the other things, are just reiterating things that we've all been through a lot of experiences in our lives, ups and downs, and we've learnt lots of things. And he's kind of reiterated those, but the main thing was showing me this big firm rock I'm standing on, and it's not a silly little thing that I might fall off.
Amazing.
And I'm looking forward to going back to TLA. I'm slightly nervous, depending on what the COVID thing's doing. Mm-hmm. But I'm sure that it'll all be, you know, everything. The church has made everything right for us to come back together. And I'm sure the same thing will happen with going into TLA. Mm. And it's going to be amazing to see everybody.
Yeah. Feels quite emotional, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Thinking about all being together, kind of worshipping all together again. It would be amazing. Well, thank you so much, ladies, for chatting with me. Absolute gold in there. Just can't wait for us to all be back together again.
Oh, that's right.
Hopefully soon in church together and worshipping together. Brilliant. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Pippa.
Hello everybody. Today we are looking again at recharging, and we're looking at Jesus in the desert. We've had loads and loads of stories about desert times, and we're going to be looking at what happened to Jesus in the desert. I'm going to read about it. Now Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, left the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wild. For 40 wilderness days and nights he was tested by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and when the time was up he was hungry. And the devil, playing on his hunger, gave the first test. Since you're God's son, command this stone to turn into a loaf of bread. And Jesus answered by quoting Deuteronomy, takes more than bread to really live. For the second test, he led him up and spread out all the kingdoms of the earth on display at once. And the devil said, they're yours in all their splendor to serve your pleasure. I'm in charge of them all, and you can turn them over to whom I wish. Worship me and they're yours. The whole works. Jesus refused again, backing his refusal with Deuteronomy. Worship the Lord your God and only the Lord your God. Serve him with absolute single-heartedness. For the third test, the devil took him to Jerusalem and put him on top of the temple. And he said, if you're God's son, jump. It's written, isn't it, that he has placed you in the care of angels to protect you. They'll catch you. You won't as much stub your toe on a stone. Yes, said Jesus. It's also written, don't you dare tempt the Lord your God. That completed the testing. The devil retreated temporarily, lying in wait for another opportunity. So there we have Jesus. Even Jesus went into the desert. When I think about Jesus, it says that he went into the desert full of the Holy Spirit, and he came out of the desert in the power of the Holy Spirit. Something happened to Jesus in the desert that gave him a greater power and a greater authority. He went in full, he came out in the power of the Holy Spirit. And so when I think about recharging myself, I don't actually think about going into a desert for 40 days and 40 nights and thinking I'll come out refreshed and full of the Spirit of God. I'll think about maybe worshipping in a meeting together with lots of people. That's when I've felt the Spirit of God maybe. Or sometimes recharging will mean going to I would love to go to a nice hotel where there's a spa and you could have a massage or something. And it definitely would involve eating me recharging. So When I think about Jesus, I think he did a very, very different thing to recharge. He went by himself in silence and in solitude into the desert, and there he spent time with God. And then the devil came. I don't know how the devil came. I don't know what that looked like. I don't know what that felt like for him, but Jesus knew that he was being tempted. First of all, in a very small way, make some bread. You're hungry, Jesus. And Jesus uses Deuteronomy and he says, no, man shall not live by bread alone. No, I'm not doing that. Then he says, then the devil says, listen, there's all these kingdoms of the earth. They'll bow down to you if you worship me. Jesus says, no, I'm not going to worship you. I will only worship the Lord my God. And then, of course, takes him to the Thai temple and says, jump down. God, you're the Son of God. You'll be protected. And Jesus says, no, I'm not going to do that. I think that it's so interesting that there are three things that I notice. The first thing is that temptation isn't wrong. It isn't a sin, is it? Jesus himself was tempted. We all are tempted. We're tempted to do things that we shouldn't do. We're tempted to do the wrong thing. All of us. Jesus was as well. And that's the first thing I notice. The second thing I notice is that the first temptation was a very, very small thing. It was like, oh, Jesus is hungry, making some bread. That's not a really terrible thing to do, is it? That's not awful. Sometimes the things that lead us into greater things that we do wrong are very small. Just a little text, just a small hello to somebody that really you shouldn't be texting. It's all that it takes. Just a small lie, a tiny lie, like it doesn't matter sort of lie, can lead into all sorts of other things. Stealing something, just a little thing, leads us sometimes into bigger things. It matters. The small things matter, and it mattered to Jesus. Then the last thing I notice is that Jesus used his power and authority that was given to him by his Father God to bless others, to empower others, to release others, to heal others, to see others flourish. And the greatest temptation he had was to use that power for himself. The greatest temptation he had was to use the power that God had given him, the authority that God had placed in his hands for his own gain, for his own self. Now, when I think about power and authority, there's obviously lots of people that have a lot of power and authority. I don't know if you feel empowered and full of authority, God's authority, or if maybe sometimes I think the greater risk is not knowing your authority at all, not knowing that you have any power. Maybe you feel helpless and powerless. Maybe you don't recognize that God, as a child of God, you have so much power. You have power to bless people. You have power to release people. You have power to pray for good things to happen in people's lives. And sometimes we don't even recognize that. And authority comes in lots of different sizes, doesn't it? Comes in lots of different places. Today, I'm speaking on the day after the Euro final, and it's a bit of a sad day. I know that this is going to be broadcast a long time in later, but it's a bit of a sad day. And yesterday, I watched Gareth Southgate go out to the guys that missed the penalty and hold them. Now, there's an authority that Gareth Southgate has got because he's gone through something. He's gone through missing a penalty. He's gone through the pain of that. He didn't even have to speak to that guy that missed the penalty. He didn't even have to have the words. There was an authority. There was an affinity with him just because he had gone through something. And so is the same for us. There's an authority given to you because of the bad things, because of the hard things that maybe you've gone through. And you can use that authority to bless people. It doesn't even have to be a lot of words. It can be just hugging somebody and them knowing that you are with them because you understand. You have been given authority. We have been given authority. And we have a choice as to how to use that. And so I pray that as we come out of the desert more and more, we will use the things that we have learned in the desert to bring life to those around us, to bring healing. And we will recognize the authority and the power that God has given us to pray for people. Jesus released people. He empowered people. He used the power that God had given him to empower others. May we do the same. And may we have gone into the desert, into that pandemic, full of the Holy Spirit. And may we come out with the power of the Holy Spirit and see what God wants to do next. So let's respond to what God wants to say to us. Just now, in your living room, just be quiet and say, God, what do you want to say to me? And I pray right now that you would know him empowering you. Maybe there are massive temptations in your life. Maybe you're struggling with that. Know that Jesus understands and he walks with you. I pray that you would know the power of the Spirit right now. So Father God, I pray that you'd come by your Holy Spirit, that you would fill us up again, Father, that we would be full of you, full of your authority. You said that all authority under heaven and earth is given to you, and you've given that to us. So I pray, Father, that you that we will use that to empower others and to see other people set free. Amen. We'll be right back.
Thanks so much for joining us this morning. We hope you've been blessed by what you've seen and you've been challenged by what you've heard this morning. We've got prayer live stream at 11:15 on YouTube, so do check that out and get involved there. And next week, please God, we should be at TLA. So please check out our social channels and the church newsletter for confirmation this week, and you'll find out all the details there. Stuff coming up, we have our generosity journey. The church relies upon financial gifts to run our activities, employ staff, facilitate the pastoral and support services that we run for the wider community. And all of us are at one stage of this journey. So wherever you are and whatever your situation, please prayerfully consider how you might be able to give to the church, which is via our website, and that's www.aaronchurch.com/donate. And equally, if you are in need of help or support, please reach out via our social media channels, which is at Arun Church, or contact our office via the website aaronchurch.com. Have a great week. God bless you. See you soon.